हेलो, गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
एनीबॉडी नीड्स टू जॉइन? आई थिंक सो, फ्यू पीपल मोर। या स्टिल 5 मिनट्स टाइम इज देयर, वी वेट फॉर 5 मिनट्स। ओनली 5 पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर गॉन। मैम मेक मी योर आई। ओके, आई वाज मेक कर। So have you gone through what I have taught? Have you gone through? I am audible. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. What is the last thing we have discussed?
Respiration in humans.
Respiration in
humans.
So have we gone through? Actually, have you people gone through? Hello? You went through your textbook, all of you? No? Okay, anyway, after this chapter, you will be having complete life process exam. Okay, only another 2 topics are left out in this chapter. After this, you will be having complete 80 marks, only life process exam. In CBSE pattern. Understood? So be prepared. Maybe this coming Sunday, not this Sunday, coming Sunday, you will be having complete life process exam. I'll share the paper with Raghavan sir. You will be having an online exam, all of you. So I'm informing you all 2 weeks before itself, almost. 10 days before, I'll try to complete both the circulatory system and excretory system today itself. And in the next class, we'll be discussing all the CBSE textbook back exercises. And so Sunday, you can write your exam. Shall we start? Yes or no? At least tell, give an answer, reply. Are all of you well, fine?
Yes, ma'am.
All of you are in good mood to listen to my class?
Yes, ma'am.
But I'm getting only 1S. So remaining are not in a good mood to listen to my class. Yes? What this ma'am is telling, repeating. All nonsense you are thinking. See, they are not even answering me. I'm pricking you all and you are not even answering me. Tell me. Shall I start the class or no?
Yes, ma'am, you can start.
Yes, ma'am.
You're ready to listen?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you going to respond when I ask?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let us start. So in today's class, we will be talking about the circulatory system and also followed by excretory system. So any idea what is the circulatory system? Any idea? Circulatory system means a system is there where the whatever the nutrients after the absorption, next after the assimilation, and finally when energy is generated by cellular respiration, now they should be transported to the different parts of the body. and also the excretory waste material should be removed from the different parts of the body. Okay, so transport of food, oxygen or carbon dioxide or removal of excretory waste will be done by a particular system, and that system is known as the circulatory system or the transport system. So mostly the multicellular organisms only have this type of a circulatory and the transport system, whereas unicellular organisms like amoeba does not have this system. Why? Because everything takes place only to a single surface by simple diffusion method. So most of the unicellular organisms does not have this well-developed circulatory system. Only multicellular, that too above the vertebrate level only, we'll be having this type of a circulatory or a transport system. So in this circulatory and transport system, there are three organs involved. 1 minute. Three organs involved. First is the heart. Next comes the blood vessels, that is arteries, veins, and also the blood capillaries. And finally, the circulating medium, that is blood and the lymph. Okay, shall I move on? Now first listen to the structure of the heart. Okay, if you need, ask you all to draw the structure of the heart, please draw this diagram. It's very easy to draw.
So what is lymph, ma'am?
I'll tell you. One by one we'll go. Okay. First, you'll be asking in the 5 marks question to draw the structure of the heart. Okay. This is the easier way to draw the structure of the heart. So first, simply put a, I'm just telling you all how to draw. First, simply put a U-shaped tube, then put the valves. And up, you can put the remaining outlets and the inlets. So please take a screenshot. I'm erasing this one. Please stay. 1 minute, I'll erase. So that it, for you, it will be easier to take a screenshot. Please take this screenshot and practice this diagram properly so that it will be very easy for you all to draw. Okay, I'll be starting explanation for you all now. So first listen, okay. So the heart consists of human heart. Here we are talking about the human heart. The human heart consists of chambers. It is divided into chambers. And the human heart has 4 chambers. So first the heart is divided as right side and the left side. So the heart, again, the right side and left side are divided into chambers. So we have 4 chambers. They are, so which, this is the right side of the heart. Okay. Right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, and left ventricle. So now, for your understanding, I'll simply draw a simple heart without any outlets and the inlets. So now this is the heart. You can see. So this is the heart. Now the heart first can be divided into right side and the left side. Okay. Again, the upper parts are known as atriums. And lower part is known as the ventricles. Okay. Now after this, when we divide the heart into 4 parts, we'll get 4 chambers. Right atrium, because the one which are present towards the right side are known as right atrium and right ventricle. And the one which is present into the left side is known as left atrium and the left ventricle. Okay. Now after this, we'll be having valves, inlet valves and the outlet valves. The valves which bring us the deoxygenated blood and the valves which will be taking, bringing the oxygenated blood and taking to the different parts of the tissue. You are able to understand till here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So these walls. Okay, first let me finish this one, then I'll explain the. So next comes the next part, that is the superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava. So these are the inlet walls which brings the deoxygenated blood towards the heart. Means from the body tissues, it will be bringing the deoxygenated blood. Deoxygenated blood means the blood that is carrying carbon dioxide. Whatever the carbon dioxide which is formed in the tissues will be exchanged with the blood. Such a blood is known as the deoxygenated blood. Now this deoxygenated blood should be brought to the hearts. Okay, so these two are the outlets. Here you can see this is the inferior vena cava which brings the blood from the lower parts of the body, that is from the limbs, hands, the all the deoxygenated blood from the stomach area. All this are brought from the inferior vena cava, whereas superior vena cava brings the deoxygenated blood from the upper parts of the body, that is the brain, head, neck regions. Okay, next comes the other one, that is pulmonary arteries. So you can see here, this is the pulmonary artery. Whatever I'm pointing out, this is the pulmonary artery. So when the deoxygenated blood, 1 minute, I'll change the color so that you can understand. So now the deoxygenated blood, which is entered the upper chamber of the heart, that is the right atrium. To which chamber of the heart the deoxygenated blood enters? It enters into the right atrium of the heart. Okay, from the via inferior vena cava and the superior vena cava. Once it enters into the right atrium, now it moves on to the left right ventricle. After we move on to the left ventricle, now it should be taken, the deoxygenated blood should be taken where? It should be taken towards the lungs, where again it can be turned back to oxygenated. So it goes out to artery known as pulmonary artery. This pulmonary artery takes the deoxygenated blood to the lungs. So the blood which entered into the right atrium moves towards the right ventricle, and from the right ventricle, it goes on to the pulmonary arteries, and from pulmonary arteries, it reaches to the, I'm keeping an arrow over on the top, it reaches over to the lungs. Okay, next coming to the pulmonary veins. We'll put another color for your understanding. I'll put a green color. Now coming to the pulmonary veins. So what is the main function of this pulmonary veins is to bring the oxygenated blood from the lungs towards the heart. Okay, whatever the oxygenated, last class we have studied how the exchange of gases takes place in the alveoli. So now that oxygenated blood will not go directly to the tissues. First it will be coming to the heart. From the heart only it will be going to the tissues. The same way how the deoxygenated blood happens. First from the tissues it comes to the heart, and from the heart only it goes to the tissue. So the, now the oxygenated blood from the lungs enters into the left atrium. Okay, the oxygenated blood from the lungs enters into the left atrium, passes to the left ventricle. And from the left ventricle, you can see over here, it passes to a artery known as aorta. So from aorta, it will be reaching on to the tissues. You are able to understand? So again, I'm going to repeat, the oxygenated blood will be entering into the left atrium of the heart, moves on to the left ventricle, and from the left ventricle it goes out of the heart via a artery known as aorta. The aorta will be taking the oxygenated blood via aorta will be going to the different tissues of the body. Okay, and aorta is the one of the largest arteries of the body. Please remember. Are you able to understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Any doubts still here?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Once I'm going to erase all this. So this is how the heart functions. Okay. So one side, it is a simultaneous process. So on the right side, always the deoxygenated blood will be coming from the tissues. Then it will be going to the lungs. In the left side, the oxygenated blood will be coming and going towards to the different organs of the body or different tissues of the body. Okay. So we hear a sound known as lub-dub. So a heart sound is lub-dub. This happens how? Okay, because this happens of the closure and the closure because of the closure of the walls. So everything should be a regulated process in the heart because it is an involuntary action. So a heart is built up with the walls. So the walls which are dividing the atrium and the ventricles are known as tricuspid and bicuspid walls. The one which is dividing the right atrium and right ventricle is known as the tricuspid wall. And the one which is dividing the left atrium and the left ventricle is known as the bicuspid wall. So this wall is known as the tricuspid wall. So there are also different names to it. I'm not giving you all the names. So just remember as tricuspid and bicuspid walls. So these, the walls that are dividing the right atrium and right ventricle is known as the tricuspid wall. You can see this is the wall. Okay. And the wall that is dividing the left atrium and the left ventricle is known as the bicuspid wall. So once here the blood has been filled and moved into the ventricles. Okay. Once the blood will be filled and moved into the ventricles, the wall, and when the ventricle in the inside the ventricles, the blood has been filled and pressure has been developed, the walls will be closed to prevent the further entry of the blood. That is the time we hear the first sound known as lub, or it is also known as systolic cloud sound. Okay, so once again I'm telling you, once the oxygen, whether it is oxygenated blood or deoxygenated blood, first any, whether it's right side or left side, first it enters the atrium. After that, it simply goes on for, goes into the ventricles and start to fill it up. Okay. So it gets filled up. Once the ventricles get filled up, the walls will be closed because it cannot, the pressure has been built up. It cannot take further blood. So this walls, when they close, we get the sound. And this is known as the systole or a lub. That is when the first sound of the heart is heard. Whereas coming to the second sound of the heart. So the walls which are guarding the flow of the blood to the aorta and the pulmonary arteries, they are also guarded by walls known as semilunar walls. These are the two semilunar walls. Okay. So the walls which are guarding the flow of blood outside the heart. Okay, it can be deoxygenated blood or it can be oxygenated blood. Okay, which are regulating the flow of blood outside the heart. That is the outlets of the heart. They are guarded by the walls known as semi-lunar walls. So as the once the blood has reached it, is filling the ventricles, it will be starting simply go on flowing out. But after a point, a pressure will be falling down, and due to that, to maintain the pressure, the walls will be closed. Okay, so the walls will be closed. That is the time we hear the closure sound, or it is known as a diastole sound or a dub sound. So the first sound is heard when there is a closure of the bicuspid and the tricuspid wall present between the atriums and the ventricles. And the second sound is heard when there is a closure of the semilunar walls, which are present near the aorta and the pulmonary artery. That is the dub sound. So this is how a simple mechanism of working of the heart takes place. So this is more than enough for y'all people in 11th and 11th standard. You will be talking in detail how those pressures will be built up and how it takes place. But for y'all, as per CBSC textbook, this is more than enough. And when they ask you to draw the structure of the heart, draw the structure of the heart, write the different parts of the heart, and write the working mechanism in a simple manner. Or you can simply go on adding this as a whatever the points I have kept as a summary, and later you can write the working model of the heart. Are you able to understand? Any doubts still?
Yes, ma'am.
Any doubts still here?
Yes, ma'am.
Huh? I'm not able to hear whoever is talking.
Ma'am, I have a doubt.
No doubts or doubts are there? I'm not able to hear you, Alima. Can you repeat? Shall I move on? Yes? Hey, speak, yaar.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then. So let us move on to the next slide. So coming to the how the circulation, again in detail now we'll be talking. So the type of circulation which we take place in the human beings is a double circulation. Okay, the type of circulation in human beings is the double circulation. Just for your understanding, I'm going to tell y'all, we usually have three types of circulation: single circulation, incomplete double circulation, and complete double circulation. So in case of human beings, we have a complete double circulation. So coming to the double circulation, in case of double circulation, it is divided into two types: systematic circulation and the pulmonary circulation. So the double circulation in case of human beings, it is a complete double circulation, and it is divided into two, that is pulmonary circulation and the systematic circulation. Why we call it as the double circulation is because the blood travels twice through the heart in one complete cycle. It travels twice through the heart, because once it comes as an oxygenated blood, again it goes back as a deoxygenated blood. So in one complete cycle, it will be traveling twice through the heart. So we call it as a double circulation. And in case of double circulation, it is of two types, that is pulmonary circulation and the systematic circulation. Coming to the pulmonary circulation, the movement of the blood from the heart to the lungs, this pathway, that is the movement of blood from the heart to the lungs, whether it is an oxygenated blood or whether it can be a deoxygenated blood. So this one is known as the pulmonary circulation. You can all know, now we have, you know, the oxygenated blood is brought by pulmonary veins to the left atrium of the heart, whereas deoxygenated blood is taken by the pulmonary artery to the lungs from the left ventricle of the heart. Okay. Next comes the systematic circulation. The movement of the blood from the heart to the body tissues is known as the systematic circulation. And the red one indicates the oxygenated blood. The blue one indicates the deoxygenated blood. So from the left ventricle, the aorta will be taking the oxygenated blood to the different parts of the tissues and blood body tissues. And the oxygen which is collected from the different body tissues will be taken to the heart, right? Atrium of the heart via vena cavas, that is a superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava. Okay, so for your understanding, I have given as a flow chart. When they ask you this double circulation, please, whatever you write, you put this in a form of a flow chart so that it will be easy to understand for the person or invigilator or whoever it is correcting. So let us see first. The deoxygenated blood via vena cavas, inferior and superior vena cavas, it will be going to the right atrium when it is in a relaxed state. From the right atrium, it goes to the right when this contracts means it's in a relaxed. Now it as it fills, it gets contracted and then goes to the right ventricle. From the right ventricle, it finally reaches the lungs. In same case, the oxygenated blood goes to the left atrium. From the left atrium, it goes to the left ventricle, and via aorta, it reaches the body parts. So this is called as the double circulation in the human heart. We have discussed with the similar picture in the previous respiratory system also. I hope all of you have understood.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you have any doubts?
No doubts, ma'am.
Can I ask you a few questions?
Yes,
ma'am. Janvi, to which part of the heart does the oxygenated blood enters? Janvi, can you hear me? You can even type if your system is not, or if your speakers are not working. So to which part of the blood, part of the heart that the oxygenated blood enters? Janvi, are you there? She left. Amrita.
Yes, ma'am.
Please answer, ma'am.
Left atrium, ma'am.
Yes. Next. Durlav.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the artery that takes the oxygenated blood to the different parts of the body?
Aorta, ma'am.
Yes. Next, Harita. Harita, unmute yourself.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the type of circulation called that takes place between the lungs and the body tissues? What is the circulation called between the lungs and the body tissues? Harita, please answer.
Pulmonary circulation.
Between the lungs. sorry, between the heart and the body tissues. Sorry.
Systematic circulation.
Yes, systematic circulation. Next, Akshita.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the vein that brings the oxygenated blood to the lungs? Sorry, to the heart.
Pulmonary veins.
Okay. What is the largest artery in our body? Anybody can answer?
Aorta.
Yes. So with this, we'll move on to the next slide. Why I ask this, these are important and confusing for you all next time. So please note all this. So it will be easy for you all when you are once again going through. So now next, what is the next part of the organ of the circulatory system is the blood vessels. So blood vessels are, we can divide them as arteries, capillaries and the veins. So what are arteries is, they take the blood away from the heart. Arteries are the vessels that take the blood away from the heart. Whereas veins are the vessels that bring, return the blood or bring the blood to the heart. So just for your understanding, I'm putting arrow. Arteries are those that take the blood away from the heart. Whereas veins are those that brings the blood to the heart. Okay, so you can see here, this is the artery and this is the vein. And these are connected by small network, small minute blood vessels, which we call them as blood capillaries. Because the exchange of gases and everything need to be taking place. So we are big, these arteries and veins are the big vessels. So they should be interconnected. They are interconnected by a small blood vessels known as capillaries. So let us see the difference between the arteries, capillaries and the veins. So it is a one of the 3 marks question. For your easier understanding, I already put your put it in form of a tabular column. You can note it down or take your screenshots if you're lazy enough. I'm not going to share any of the PPTs. I'm telling you before itself. You should note down. I'm giving you sufficient time to note down. Okay. So function. Arteries carry the blood away from the heart at a high pressure. First, let us see the veins. Next. Whereas the veins return the blood to the heart at a low pressure. Whereas capillaries supply all the cells with their requirements and take away the waste products. They will be supplying the cells whatever they require, whether it's oxygen or whatever it is. And also will be taking away the waste products. Next, coming to the structure of what, how they are made up of. So arteries are thick, strong, contains muscles, elastic fibers and fibrous tissue. Veins are thin, mainly fibrous. The walls are very thin. Okay, the thin means the walls. Mainly fibrous, contains very lesser muscles and less elastic compared to that of arteries. Whereas capillaries, because these are very minute muscles, veins, they are very, the cell walls are very thin and only one cell thick. Coming to the lumen, lumen means, if these are the capillary, the space between these two walls, the gap, this is called the middle space is known as lumen. Okay, the lumen here
middle
is very
space between what, ma'am?
What, ma?
You told lumen is space, ma'am. Between what, ma'am?
If this is the vessel, ma, like a vessel, the gap between these two walls means where the blood flow will be taking place. This is known as the lumen.
Okay, ma'am, I understand.
Now, if you have a pipe, the middle one, the inside that pipe, whatever the space or gap is there, or a vacuum is there, that is known as, we call it as a vacuum. Here we call it as a lumen.
Okay.
So in case the lumen is narrow, and varies with the heartbeat. As because it is elastic, it can slightly the size or diameter may increase or decrease. Whereas veins have a very wide lumen, and in case of capillaries, as you know, it has a very narrow lumen, only enough for the red blood cells to pass through. Nothing can enter it. Only red blood cells can pass through it. Next, coming to the walls. Walls means, if this is the vessel, whether it can be artery or a vein. So in some, there will be always a blocks like this. In case of arteries, nothing of this will be present. It is open. No walls will be present. Even in the capillaries, no walls will be present. Whereas in veins, we have these walls. Why is, what is the main function of the veins? It will be carrying the blood from towards the heart. Means it is going against the gravity, from the, especially from the lower body. You should be carrying the blood towards the heart. So to prevent the backflow, always they have these valves present in the veins. So to prevent, once it enters this part, this valve will be closed. Once it enters, the blood enters this valve will be closed. So to prevent the backflow of the blood, these valves will be present in the veins. Whereas the arteries and the capillaries will not have this valve. So how the structure fits the its function? So this is why the strength and elasticity needs to be to hold the pulsing of the blood and prevent it to may prevent the bursting and maintaining the pressure wave. Helps to maintain the high blood pressure and prevents the blood flowing backwards. So why this strength and elasticity is required for the arteries is, how this helps it. First of all, it is taking the blood from the heart. So heart is a highly functioning organ, and it has a high pulsating nature. So it need to maintain that that strength and elasticity is needed to maintain the, as it takes the blood from the heart. So this structure helps the arteries to maintain it. Whereas for this, nothing is required. They don't need to require any strong walls or no need to maintain any blood pressure. Capillaries does not require. Only because only exchange of gases or removal of waste only will be taking place from the tissues. So its walls are thin walled. And due to that, easy diffusion, the exchange of gases will be taking place between the tissues as well as in the lungs. We have already studied. In the alveoli, where they are thin-walled, blood capillaries are also thin-walled, exchange of gases will be taking place in a simple diffusion manner. Whereas coming to the veins, so these veins does not require any strong walls because they no need to maintain any blood pressure because they're taking the blood to the pulsating organ, to the from different tissues to the highly pulsating organ. Okay, so due to that, they have a very wider ones. And to prevent the backflow of the blood, they have the walls. So these are the different differences between the arteries, capillaries, and the veins. Hope you understood. Shall I move on?
1 minute.
I'm erasing. So that. The thick and thin means the thickness of the wall and thinness of the wall. Please remember, I did not mention it. When you are writing, please write the walls. The walls are thick, the walls are thin. Artery walls are thick and artery walls are thin. Your veins are thin, walls are thin.
Ma'am, in that structure of wall, what does like fibrous tissue mean, ma'am?
Which one, ma'am?
Ma'am, in structure of wall, ma'am.
Veins, sir?
Yes, ma'am. For both arteries and veins, what is like fibrous tissue, ma'am?
Means we have different types. These are made up of different tissues and muscles. Okay. So in the muscle here is elastic, whereas the tissue made is fibrous. We have different types of skeletal muscles. I think so you have studied in your 9th class.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, So here they are made up of fibrous tissue. In case of arteries, they are made up of fibrous tissue and elastic muscles. Whereas in veins, they are more less fibrous and less elastic.
Okay.
Shall I move on, ma'am?
Ma'am, please wait, ma'am.
Okay. Done.
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we'll see the different components of the blood. So now we have come to the circulating medium, that is the blood and the lymph and the plasma, all this. So what does the blood contains? So first you can see here the blood is divided into 1 minute. So the blood is divided into three parts. What does the blood contains? The blood contains, sorry, it's divided into two parts. The blood contains plasma and blood cells. Please write in full names. I'm not able to write. So the blood is divided into two parts. So one part is the plasma. Other part is the blood cells. Again, the blood cells are divided into three parts. First one is the RBC, or we call it as red blood cells. Second one is the WBC. We call it as white blood cells. And third one is the platelets. Again, I'm repeating. Coming to the components of the blood is broadly divided first into two parts. That is the platelets and the blood cells. So the plasma and the blood cells. Again, the blood cells are divided into three parts. RBC, that is also known as red blood cells, WBC, known as white blood cells, and platelets. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Now coming to the, what does the plasma contains? So let us discuss in detail about the each and the every part. So this, if you go for a lab test, after they collect the blood, they will be centrifuging it. When they centrifuge, we'll be getting in these three parts. So the upper part, the yellowish part, is known as the plasma. In between, we'll be getting a small, it will be looking like a whitish, bluish in color. Those are contains the platelets and the white blood cells, and the bottom one is known as the red blood cells. Okay, so first let us tell about the plasma. So what is the plasma? Is pale yellow in color, and it contains only salts, nutrients, water, and the enzymes. And it also contains the important proteins required for coagulation, blood coagulation, are present in the plasma. And what is its main function? What is its main function is to transport carbon dioxide and nitrogenous waste in different dissolved form to the different parts of the body. So what is main function is to transport or carry carbon dioxide and nitrogenous waste in dissolved form. And why is very, nowadays, you all also must be studying papers. Most of them are going for plasma donations due to this COVID. I think so all of you heard about it.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, why? Because the plasma contains huge amount of proteins which are required for blood coagulation, and also many antibodies are also present in the plasma itself. So only when we are going for any when we have any acute infect, chronic infections like COVID or dengue or whatever, what happens to the patient is first the plasma levels will be coming down, means the protein levels will be coming down. Due to that, now they are asking different people matching with the person's blood sample, trying to go for the plasma donations. So usually we go give plasma transfusions when the patient is in his chronic conditions like life-threatening injuries or liver failure, so that more immunity will be built up, because they carry proteins and antibodies in addition to water, ions, nutrients, gases, etc. So this is one of the one mark question. Function of the plasma and complete plasma is a 3 marks question. Next, coming to the components of the red blood, blood cells present. As I told you, there are 3 components involved, that is RBC known as red blood cells, WBC known as white blood cells, and finally the platelets known as, we call it as platelets or blood platelets. Now coming to the RBC. RBC contains a protein known as hemoglobin. And they are mainly where they are originated is RBCs are formed in the bone marrow of the bones. And its main function is, it is usually red in color, and its main function is to carry the oxygen and carbon dioxide. Okay, oxygen will be attached to the hemoglobin and it will be carried to the different parts of the body, whereas carbon dioxide, as we studied, will be present in a dissolved form as bicarbonate and will be taken to the heart. Next, coming to the WBC. You can see the shapes over here. I have given you the shapes also. So RBC usually is in a concave shape. It is like a concave shape. Whereas coming to the WBC, there are many cells present in the WBC. Okay, like eosinophils, basinophils, neutrophils, lymphocytes, monocytes. So that much detail is not there in CBSC class 10. So you simply can write it as WBC itself, collectively write it as WBC. But for your understanding, I'm telling you all. So again, WBC has 5 different cells. Here I'm just writing the one word for it. So they are eosinophils, basophils, neutrophils, neutrophils, lymphocytes, and monocytes. Okay. So what is the main function of this WBC is they are responsible for fighting the foreign pathogens. Okay, such as bacteria, virus, and fungi that is entering to the body. Because for example, lymphocytes, these are the places where they will be, these are the cells that secrete the antibodies in our body. Okay, lymphocytes are the cells which are present, which are the part of WBC, will be secreting the antibodies required for our body. Whereas eosinophils, basinophils, all these also secrete different types like histamines and all the allergic reactions, whatever we get, all these will be secreted. So they will be able to combat the foreign pathogens which are entering our body. It can be bacteria, virus, or fungi. Okay. And these WBC are again originated from the bone marrow itself. So the main function is to neutralize the antigen. What, ma?
Can you say what is bone marrow?
What is bone marrow? So if this is the bone, the inside part of the bone is known as the bone marrow. It will be present in a reddish color. That is known as the bone marrow. And this is the place where the WBCs and RBCs are originated or prepared. From here only we originated or we prepared. Okay. So only when any person has a blood cancer or anything, first what they do is they go for a bone marrow transplant.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So again, I'm repeating, the main function of the WBC is to give us immunity to our body or to protect us from the foreign pathogens by releasing antibodies, which will be combating with the antigens. Antigens are nothing but the pathogens. It can be virus, bacteria, or fungi. You all been studying in the papers if you study regularly. And the whatever the antibodies release will be helping us to protect it from the pathogen, these pathogens or the antigens. So that is the function of the WBCs. Next, coming to the platelets. So platelets are the thin disc-like structures. And its main function is blood clotting. So when there is an injury to our body, it can be a small wound or big wound. We always, after an injury is there, what will happen? The blood capillaries will be cut. So the blood will be flowing out of our body. So immediately, these platelets reaches the wound area and start the blood clotting. They release the cells known as thrombocytes, and these thrombocytes will be producing thrombin, which helps in the clotting of the blood. So its main function is blood clotting or blood coagulation. Can you understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So here there is a reaction. How the blood coagulation takes place. That is protrombin to thrombin, fibrinogen to fibrin. Only those two steps. Okay. For y'all, this is the activity. I want you all to go, Google it and write the sequence of the how that one will be for a blood clot is formed. Understood? All of you noted down? How does the blood coagulation takes place? This is your question. I want the sequence of steps. Done? Have written?
Yes, ma'am.
Next question. What are the different cells present in the WBC and their functions? Have you
read? Ma'am, can you repeat the question once more?
What are the different cells present in the WBC and their functions?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Next, I'm moving on to the next. Next comes to the lymph. The lymph is a colorless solution. Okay. First, let me explain what is lymph. Then I'll tell you all the lymphatic pathway. Okay. So lymph is a modified tissue fluid. It is also known as tissue fluid and only contains cells that is lymphocytes, monocytes, salts, and small amount of proteins. Whereas plasma, we have studied, contains a lot of proteins. But lymph does not contain any blood clotting proteins or any other proteins are not present in the lymph. Only small amount of proteins are only present in the lymph. Lymph is also known as tissue fluid, but it contains cells, that is lymphocytes and the monocytes, whereas plasma does not contain any cells. Okay? And plasma flows towards the within blood vessels, whereas lymph flows through the lymphatic vessels. We'll see what it is. No coagulation. Actually, here they told that coagulation takes place very slowly, very very little minute coagulation.
What is coagulation?
Clotting of blood.
Okay.
Blood clotting or blood coagulation is the same term. Okay. Very minute coagulation takes, because blood proteins, the proteins required for blood coagulation, that is prothrombin, thrombin, which I told you all, gave you as activity now. Okay, those proteins will not be present in the lymph. Blood clotting proteins are minute, are not present in the lymph. Whereas large amounts of the blood clotting proteins, that is fibrinogen and prothrombin, will be present, and this helps in the blood coagulation. Now coming to the function, the main important function. It supplies nutrition to the tissues devoid of the blood plasma, blood supply, and takes part in the fat absorption as well as in the defense mechanism of the body. So wherever the blood cannot flow to those tissues, it will be supplying the nutrients and the nutrition required, as well as it takes a very important role in fat absorption and the defense mechanism of the body, because it has the cells, that is lymphocytes and monocytes. Whereas what is the function of the plasma? It takes part in nutrition excretion, respiration, by transporting various parts, materials and defense mechanism bodies by producing antibodies. This is not correct term. Sorry, please don't write it. It only transports the nutrients, gases, and the waste products to the different parts of the body. That is the function of the plasma. Now coming to the lymphatic system, how we
can you go to the previous slide for a minute?
1 minute, I'll tell you. Let me finish this, then I'll move to the previous again. Huh? Let it be a
continuation. Okay,
let it be a continuation. Okay. So as now you can see, this red one is the oxygenated blood, whereas the blue one is the deoxygenated blood. So once they reach the blood capillaries, always there will be a leakage. Okay, always there will be a leakage into the space between the tissues. Okay, that space is known as interstitial space. So the fluid which is leaked from these blood capillaries is known as the tissue fluid, or it is now known as the lymph. Lymph is a colorless fluid. So this fluid will be collected by a capillary known as ESMA. As the blood or exchange of blood enters into the blood capillaries, or it's leaving the tissues from the blood capillaries, always there will be a loss or leakage of the, not loss, leakage of the fluid from the blood capillaries into the, if these are the tissues, always there will be a small gap between the tissues. So this gap, whatever the gap is there, no, this gap is known as the interstitial space. This gap, whatever the gap is there, this gap is known as the interstitial space. So this, as the exchange is taking place, the tissues, the space between the, these tissues will be filled with the fluid. Whatever the fluid which is leaked out is known as tissue fluid. Or it is okay. Also known as the lymph. Understood?
Yes, ma'am, understood.
Now this fluid, because it's leaking and it should not be filled up, it should be collected back into the system. Okay? we have a capillaries known as lymphatic capillaries. This whatever the leak tissue fluid or lymph will be collected by these lymphatic capillaries. From there, they will be entering into the lymph node and via lymphatic trunk finally return back to the heart. Understood? So this is the pathway. So the tissue fluid first enters the lymphatic capillaries. From the lymphatic capillaries, they enter the lymph node. Then they enter the lymphatic trunk and finally return back to the heart. To which side of the heart? To the right atrium of the heart. Right side of the heart or right atrium of the heart. Why I'm asking you this is, why I'm telling you this is, in one mark questions, they have asked the pathway, to write the pathway in the form of arrows in one of the sample papers. Because from 2 years, more exams are not being done properly. So they have asked this as a multiple choice question. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
And now you can copy the differences between the plasma and the lymph.
Ma'am, what is the meaning of coagulate?
What is the meaning of
coagulate?
I'm not able to hear you, ma'am.
Ma'am, what is the meaning of coagulate, ma'am?
Coagulate means blood clotting. Clotting of blood.
Okay, ma'am.
Shall I move on?
One minute, ma'am.
Finish?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
One minute. Okay. One second.
Okay.
Complete.
Okay. Now, difference between the serum and plasma. There is another thing known as serum. So, when we now this is the blood. This is the blood, complete whole blood. After we centrifuge it, we get two parts. Okay, the blood clot and the upper yellow one is known as the serum. And this is the plasma. What is serum is nothing but plasma minus clotting factors is known as a serum. Plasma minus clotting factors means all the thrombin, prothrombin, the all those clotting factors are not there, no? That is known as serum. No cells will be present, as well as no clotting factors will be present. Whereas in case of lymph, cells will be present, but clotting factors will not be present. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Can I move on?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So these are the functions of the blood. It is a fluid, connective tissues, provide oxygen to their cells, transport hormones and nutrients. It maintains hemostasis. Hemostasis means it maintains the body temperature. Blood clot, it contains the blood clotting factors and also bring the blood clotting factors to the site of injury. Transports waste to the kidneys and the livers, protects our body against pathogens because it contains many antibodies. You can extend these points also.
Ma'am, can you explain what is hemostasis?
Hemostasis means, yes, ma'am, maintaining the body temperature.
Okay, ma'am.
Done?
1 minute, ma'am.
Should I move on? Should I move on?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. Now coming to the blood pressure. So our blood pressure is always 120 by 80. The blood pressure is always 120 by 80. 120 is the systolic pressure, whereas 80 is the diastolic pressure. And the blood pressure is measured by an instrument known as sphygmomanometer. So you should write what is the normal blood pressure of the human beings means 120 by 80 mm of Hg. It is a mm of Hg is like a unit. So in blood pressure, we have two types again. 120 indicates the systolic pressure and 80 indicates the diastolic pressure. So first, always after we, I think say all of you have gone through, after they have put a cup and they build up the pressure, the when the first sound we'll be hearing at 120 degrees, that is known as the systolic pressure. Whereas the last sound will be heard at 80 degrees, that is known as the diastolic pressure. And the instrument used to measure is known as a sphygmomanometer. Now, in some people, usually they have this, we can even tell these are the genetic diseases or lifestyle disease or whatever. That is the blood fluctuation of blood pressure. Okay. They may be having a low blood pressure or some may be having a high blood pressure. The low blood pressure is known as hypotension and usually it will be less than 90 by 60 mm of Hg. Whereas the high blood pressure is known as hypertension and it will be more than 140 by 90 mm of Hg.
Ma'am, I had a doubt on serum, ma'am.
What,
ma'am? Ma'am, where is it present in our body, ma'am?
It's not present in the body. It's not present in the body. I'm telling you this in the test tube.
Okay.
When we centrifuge the blood in the test tube, it will be divided into two parts by you adding coagulants or anything. We have anticoagulants. Okay. So when we add them, it is divided into two parts. Blood clot containing RBC, WBC, platelets, everything, and only serum. Serum is nothing.
Then will there be some chemicals or something like that added?
Yes. Coagulating factors. So we'll be adding, we don't add those coagulating factors. Okay. Some experiments. So you must be going to the labs and giving your blood. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
And they will be putting in different vials. Okay. Usually in the vials, no, they add this anticoagulating chemicals. Means they don't allow the blood to clot. Okay. At that time, they can means RBC, WBC, plasma, everything they can do and separate also. When we are donating the blood also, they'll keep these anticoagulating factors so that the blood will be in its normal condition. But if the blood which is coming out of the body, if we don't put these chemicals, that is the anticoagulating chemicals, immediately clot. Immediately it will be clot and be separated in this way. That is yellow fluid and the blood clot. So the upper yellow fluid is known as serum. Understood?
Yes, ma'am, understood.
So okay, the low pressure, what will be doing? Anybody know about the low blood pressure? What happens? Circulation will be affected. First thing, the person will become weak and tired. Whereas high blood pressure, there will be increase of anxiety, nervousness, and all those. With this, we have completed the transport in the human beings. Now we'll be talking about the transport in the plants. So in transport in plants is very simple process. So we all know that there are two vessels in the plants that are known as xylem and the phloem. So xylem will be carrying in the upward direction only. Please remember, if this is the plant, always xylem will be carrying water and minerals only in the upward direction. Okay, it will be carrying the water and minerals from the roots to the different parts of the plant, and it is unidirectional, only in the upward direction, and no energy is required for this one. Whereas in case of phloem, the main function of the phloem is to transport whatever the food which is prepared in the leaves to the different parts of the plant. So it will be moving in both the direction. It will be moving in a upward direction as well as in the downward direction. So it's bidirectional. And here the energy is required. So xylem is used only to transport water and minerals from the roots to the different parts of the body, whereas phloem transport the food which is prepared in the photosynthesis from the leaves to the different parts of the body. Sorry, different parts of the plant. So the transport of food from the leaves to the different parts of the plant via phloem is known as translocation. Transport of food from the leaves to the different parts of the plant via phloem is known as translocation. And next, another place where the transport takes place is known as transpiration. I think so. We have studied about this transpirational pool and how the temperature is regulated and maintained in photosynthesis in the first class. Hope you remembered. Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So this is how it takes place. So this is the complete transport in the plants, where the water and minerals are taken by from the roots and transported to the different parts of the plant. Whereas the glucose, which is prepared, will be taken from the leaves to the different parts of the plant, and it can be bidirectional. You can see the arrows. Upward is going as well as the downward also it's growing. Whereas the water will be going only in the upward direction. So this is how the water is transported. This is the pathway involved, just for your understanding only. The absorption of ions by the roots from the soil, then the movement of water into the root xylem, then water and then to the stem xylem, then to the xylem in the leaves, and there will be loss of water from the stomata in the leaves. This is process known as transport. Due to that, the suction pressure will be built and the movement of water will be taking place in the upward direction. This is also known as suction pull or transpirational pull, which we have discussed in the classroom. Sorry, class two, I guess. Understood? Shall I move on? Any doubts? Any doubts?
So
with this, we have completed the circulatory system, both in human beings as well as the plants. So with this, I'll conclude the class. I'm not able to start even the excretory system. In the next class, I'll be starting with the excretory system. It's a very small one and we'll follow it by a discussion with the questions. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So be prepared for your exam. I will tell you what date and what time. Maybe the next week after completing the excretory system, we'll keep you all the exam. Maybe not on Sunday because only 2 days will be there for you all to read. We'll see what time.
Yes, ma'am.
So with this, I conclude. Yes, ma'am. With this, I conclude the class. Any doubts is there, you can ask me.
No doubt.
Okay, then. Thank you. Take care. Be careful. Don't go outside your houses.
Thank you, ma'am.
Be very, very careful. Okay? I see.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.